Greetings, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Game Sharks, the greatest video game show recorded in this room. I am one of your hosts, Jimmy Good, and joining me, as always, is my co-host, Mr. Cory Laing. Cory, how are you?
You just keep breaking in here.
I do.
We lock the doors.
I'm back, baby.
The snow. What are you doing here? Isn't it like nice and warm in California?
I suppose so, but what can I say? The allure of QC and yes. You and video game talk, it brought me back. And also the holidays, because I think mom might be watching this. So that was the real reason I came back.
Yeah, well, we're happy you're here.
Well, thank you.
Welcome home.
Thank you so much. It's so good
nice
to be here.
Nice to see you.
I appreciate it. I love the cold, dark days.
Yeah. It's getting better, though. I mean, I think today felt like a heat wave.
A little bit of a heat
compared
wave.
Compared to the last like week or so.
That's true.
So my poor dog, he walks out there, he just stands there, doesn't know what to do.
Sure.
And then we got to go out there and scoop him up. It's a nightmare. So the weather is appreciated.
Yeah, no, I agree. And it's so funny because you spend just a couple days under 0 degrees and you're like, wow, anything above that feels like it's a day at the beach.
Yeah.
So when I go back to California, it'll be crazy.
I'm coming with you.
Come, Cory, I'm bringing everybody here with, everybody at QC. No more shows. We're just going to California, baby.
Yep.
But today we're not just going to talk about just the weather. We've got a bunch of games to talk about because I've been a busy boy. Yes, I sent the rundown to Cory. Cory's like, oh my gosh, you've been playing a lot.
Impressive.
And I promise I've not been avoiding my family. It's just been one of those things that I've gotten a chance to just sit down and not film theme parks for a day or two. But I want to start today with a game that just came out at the time of this recording, and that's High on Life. This game came out on Xbox Game Pass and a bunch of other places as well, but that's where I played it. Mm-hmm. And it is a first-person shooter that is starring the voice and creative mind of Justin Roiland, who you guys might know from Rick and Morty or Solar Opposites. Now, we were talking before the show about this, and I know you've got some questions, and I want to get into it as much as possible. Is there anything up front you want to know before I dive in?
Well, I'm familiar with the game. I'm familiar with the backstory and the talent behind it. I was never really into Rick and Morty.
Sure.
I don't dislike it. I've just never really got into it.
Sure.
But I've seen the trailers. I think the art style is very reminiscent of like some 90s kind of cartoons and stuff. So
totally.
I'm interested.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I will say this. I don't know how many games they have under their belt yet at this Squanch Games, but this clearly is like one of their very first ones, and it seems like they got funding to go bigger and crazier than they originally thought.
Have they done a Rick and Morty game prior to this?
Not that I know of. Okay. There's probably some out there. Someone's
mobile game or something.
Yeah, exactly. But it very much feels like that style of humor, at least.
Sure.
So all of your guns or your armaments, they're called Gatlians, they all have faces and they talk to you while you're playing. So it's various comedians or other voice actors and they're kind of yelling at you
Jack
or talking
Black,
to
right?
you.
Or no?
He does, I may or may not be a cameo at some point. He's not one of the guns though.
Okay, because I don't think that's a spoiler, is it?
I don't know.
I thought I read that like Jack Black was straight up in the game.
He is, it's at the very end, it's for like a few seconds.
Well, apologize if
it's
that's
okay.
A spoiler.
I don't know. If anyone watches, they're like, I'm not playing this now.
Yeah, no? right.
Somebody and another famous person shows up as well.
Okay.
It's very fun. But it's so funny because when I was playing this, it feels a little bit like it wants to be Ratchet and Clank with like the fun guns and like fun kind of weird worlds you go to.
Sure.
But in a first person
perspective. Over the top wacky.
Yeah. And the guns themselves feel all right, but it's clearly like their first real stab at this genre.
Mm-hmm.
So again, not bad per se, but clearly like the first step for them. Like we'll look back on this and be like, oh, they learned so much from this first game, hopefully.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's so funny too because not only are the certain like the different guns like effective in different ways, but I found myself gravitating towards a few that I like their personalities of versus if they were very effective in combat. And I was like, I just want to have you out all the time because they were talking to me so frequently, and I think they must have recorded so much dialogue because almost all the guns, it seems like, would react to every story scenario for the most part, depending on who you had out.
Got it.
Which was really cool.
Okay.
It's an interesting game. It was not super long, I'll say that much. It's very much a bite-sized type of thing, it seemed like.
That's interesting to me, then.
Yes. And there was like probably extra stuff I could have gone back and done, but for the most part, it was very straightforward.
Okay.
I wanted to check the time on it. I think I was like maybe 8 to 10 hours.
Oh, wow. It's pretty short. That sounds appealing.
I'm
into that.
Yeah, which I think, like we've talked about this a few times, maybe even on this show, the older we get, the more appealing like a shorter game is. Because like nowadays when they're like, it's 300 hours to beat the main game, I'm like, I can't, no, please.
I guess it depends. Billy was a guest on the last show when you were in California. Mm-hmm. He brought up, you know, value, like a a value standpoint.
Yes.
Like, sure, it's nice to be able to beat a game in 8 to 10 hours, but then it brings up the value proposition.
Of course.
It's a $60 price tag. Yeah. So I guess that would be my question. Is this a full retail priced game?
That is the question, right? And that's okay. That's for
you. Played it on Game Pass.
I played it on Game Pass, okay. So that's why I'm going to be skewed either way.
Right.
So I'm not sure if I'm
that's the way to do it.
Yeah, because it feels like with that, it's like a subscription service. It's like watching a movie on Netflix, like watching Glass Onion that just came out there. It's like you can watch there versus going to see it in theaters.
Right. Yeah, and especially if it's an, I mean, would you replay this game?
I don't know. You'd have to really, I think, enjoy the humor.
Okay.
I think.
Then you'd probably just strike for a month of Game Pass.
Yeah,
spend the $16, beat the game, and then move on with your life.
That's how I
save $45.
That's how I feel about it, kind of, sort of. And again, I did enjoy it for what it was.
Yeah.
It wasn't the same type of, like, feel that you, like, you play Doom because it feels good.
Got it.
You play this game because you like the humor.
Got
and, like, the weird, wacky characters.
Yeah. Are the jokes built into, like, a random algorithm, or are they very scripted and timed?
It's pretty scripted and timed for the most part, but sometimes it'll be like you haven't used this gun in a while, and they'll be like, hey, I was getting really bored sitting in the holster.
Got
like, you know,
it.
Stuff like that, you know.
I'm just curious if that would fuel the replayability.
Sure.
Like if the jokes were random.
Sure.
So maybe not so much.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that would be, it doesn't seem to be the case.
Okay.
But again, there's just a few guns that I liked specifically. There's one called Creature. I really enjoyed him because he has these little babies that you shoot out, and his babies go out and attack people, and then they die. He makes jokes about that. He's like, I love you like family, and he's like, and also I've got my little babies here. But it's also a very rated.
Is that the JB Smooth character? He plays Leon in Curb Your Enthusiasm.
It could
he's like
be
one
that
of my
guy.
Favorite characters in that show. He's a voice in this new game. I'm just not sure which weapon.
He might be that
JB Smooth, I believe, is the actor's name.
Could be that.
Could probably confirm behind the camera. But anyways.
I really, there's a few, like I said, that were really so enjoyable to just listen to. And once you got them into your arsenal, you just liked, for me, I just like to hang out with them.
Okay. That's cool.
Yeah.
This looks really cool.
And you can upgrade stuff, like actually all the guns you can upgrade, and you can upgrade, you have your own suit and things like that. So there's a level of intensity or complexity there on top of the fact you have like a dash. And then you also have like a jet boost dash, and then you get a jet pack later on.
Okay.
And then you have a knife that also doubles as a grapple hook.
Oh, funny.
But the knife named Knifey, who I also love, he's Australian, and he's just really, really mean, or he just really wants to hurt people.
Yeah.
Because he's a little knife.
Yeah.
And he's like, he's your friend, but he's like, I would turn on you in an instant if I got to stab you.
Strong, like, Who Framed Roger Rabbit vibes.
It's like Who Framed Roger Rabbit, but like R-rated.
Got it. With like a Futurama kind of look to
it. Yes. This is very M for mature.
It
might look like a kid's game.
Sure.
But you'd have to mute it.
Yeah, yeah.
Even then, there's some stuff, there's some visuals where you're like, okay, this is not one of those games that you're going to be like, all right, grab the 6 and 8 year olds and let's have them play this.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's really wacky though. And it's like a fun, interesting change of pace for a shooter, I think. Mm-hmm. Because I'm so used to them playing it all straightforward. And another reason why I think of Ratchet & Clank is because of like the off-color humor. But this one is just cranked all the way up. So if you like Rick and Morty or Solar Opposites, you would, I think, adore this game because it feels like it was an episode that they just were like, what if we made a whole video game about this?
Right.
You know.
Right.
So
cool.
Yeah,
well,
any interest. That's the question.
Yes, I do want to check it out at some point. Game Pass seems like the right avenue for me to hop behind the wheel on that one.
Yes.
But yeah, I look at the trailer and I'm like, that looks like something from the 90s.
Yes.
And I'm all about that. So yeah.
Yeah.
I definitely want to check it out at some point.
One other caveat I do want to make about this, though, is that you really, like I said before, you have to like the humor because there are times when you're sitting and watching conversations play out and you're playing as a mute protagonist.
Mm.
And so that conversation can go for like 2 minutes or more.
Got
and you're
it.
Just kind of sitting there and you
Got
have
it.
To like, you're absorbing the
sure.
story. So again, keep that in mind. But this is like a first real, again, to use Knifey, a stab at something.
Nice.
And I'm excited to see where it goes in the future because I feel like this is just the beginning. And there was like 4 or 5 guns, like major guns that I had in the game.
Okay.
So it's not like a huge, like there are 20, 30, 40 guns,
right.
You know, because that's going to be harder. You have to get more and more voice actors.
This isn't Borderlands.
Yeah, which again, that would be great. I would love to be a gun in this game, you know, or a Gatling, I should say.
Sure.
But yeah, it's decent. I thought it was good.
Cool.
And it's worth checking out.
A strong 7 or 8 out of 10.
Especially on Game Pass, man. It's just sitting there. It's like, download me.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, I'll give it a little shot. Yeah. You know, for the channel and all that stuff. So for the show. But yeah, so there we go. Yeah, I'm excited to hear you. I want to hear your thoughts eventually on it.
Yes.
You know.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'll check it out.
Okay, but Cory, you have a prop here today.
I do.
It's been sitting. It's the elephant in the room, besides yours truly. So what do we have here? What's in this magical case?
Yeah, so... So long story short, I bought the OLED Switch, and my wife took one look at it and fell in love with it. So she took that immediately. Which is okay.
Yeah.
I mean, so I was like, well, why don't we get the Steam Deck as well? So I got the Steam Deck.
Okay.
So made by Valve.
Did obviously. Gabe Newell deliver it himself?
Yes, he did.
Oh, my gosh,
yeah,
Gabe.
FedEx truck driver with Gabe and shotgun.
That's great. Thanks, yeah. Gabe. Thanks, Gabe.
Yeah, so this is the Steam Deck.
Wow.
I'm sure people... I can put up some...
It's from the future.
Some videos look and this. Still shots, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I feel like I'm on The Price is Right all of a sudden. Yeah. Oh, there we go. There we
yep.
go. Ah.
But it is, in a nutshell, a portable PC... made by Valve that runs Linux and Steam.
Nice.
You can, you know, step into like a desktop mode and install Windows.
Oh.
So theoretically, you can play Game Pass games on the Steam Deck.
Okay, wow.
You can dock it to a monitor or a TV, and it just turns into like a little kind of a portable PC, kind of like the Switch, but much more powerful.
Cool.
Obviously, I don't know if you noticed, there's some back panel
buttons, nice.
And then there's some haptic switches and stuff here. So, yeah, I'm really digging it so far. Mainly, I wanted to play Elden Ring on the couch.
Sure.
So I've bought that game twice now.
Oh, my gosh.
And nice. Runs great, looks great. I'll put up some little B-roll of the Steam Deck, so I'm sure it's a little easier for people to see. But, yeah, so I've been tinkering with this for probably about a week and a half, 2 weeks. Range of different things from indie to AAA games. Seems to be optimized really well for games like Resident Evil 2 Remake, which I've been playing, Elden Ring.
Cool.
The thing that surprised me, which I was relieved about, was... You know, with a PC game, you got to open up those settings. You got to pull sliders back and forth to get it to cooperate with the specs of your of your PC. This seems like really optimized right off the bat.
Oh, nice.
I could pull up menus for you, but people probably won't be able to see it. But when you go into the storefront, it's organized by optimization. So, like, there's a whole storefront that's, like, guaranteed these games will run really well on the Steam Deck. We've already done the optimization. We've done the work. So I thought that was really smart.
That's great.
The Valve went through and did that.
Very smart.
But then there's other categories where, like, hey, this is going to run fine, but, like, it might be a little sketchy in this department.
Sure.
And then there's other tiers like, I wouldn't trust it, but you're probably fine.
Sure, yeah.
So it's, like, really kind of funny, but, like, they put, like, a green check mark next to games that... I forget the verbiage they use, but it's like great on deck or some.
Oh,
they
sure.
have some buzzword.
Sure, sure.
I don't want to go back to my Switch
really?
After playing this.
Well, yeah,
I don't want to go back to my PlayStation after playing this. It is an incredible gaming device, and I haven't even gotten to like the emulation stuff.
Oh, really? Okay.
Like you can run GameCube games. I mean,
that'd be nice.
I'm not going to go too extreme, but you know, I will probably do some emulation stuff with it.
Sure.
Which I'm looking forward to. So, yeah, that's the Steam Deck. Comes with this nice little hard shell carrying case. And then there's a little back panel that you can stick your power cord.
Oh, wow.
Kind of keeps it in there nice.
Nice.
So, yeah, it's a Switch. It's a powerful Switch.
Sweet.
You know, they saw what Nintendo did, and they're like, hey, we could do that.
Yeah.
We already have a software and an OS with Linux, so why not make a little... handheld device. So
interesting. All right, I've got a few things I would like to bring up with this.
Okay.
So first off, I love this optimization thing because I remember being a kid getting the video game City of Heroes.
Yeah.
And I had a PC and I thought it was also on PC, but I was like, you can't run this.
Yeah.
And that's one of my favorite things about the consoles is that when you buy a game for Series X or PlayStation 5 or whatever, if it says that, it will play it.
You're good to go.
You don't have to do this whole like,
yep.
Do I have to download some driver to do the thing? You know?
Yeah.
So that I think is brilliant.
Yeah, I feel like they built a sturdy bridge between like what you just described as that reliable console performance, even though console games now have like performance mode and resolution mode. It's like, okay, I'm always going to play in performance. But yeah, you do get a console vibe with this, especially with that separate green checkmark storefront where you're guaranteed that like Valve has worked with the publisher and the developer to make sure that this game is up to the standards you'd expect on a PS5 or an Xbox. You know, I haven't tried a lot of games. The great thing was I already had a backlog of Steam games.
Sure.
So I already had access to a huge library of games.
Yeah.
And so far, everything I've installed runs fantastic.
Okay, no problems, no hiccups so far?
No,
okay,
I think like it crashed on me once during like Super Meat Boy. And
okay.
I think it locked up once on Resident Evil 2, but so far like 99% smooth sailing.
Sure,
so, okay.
Well, that's Mr. X though for Resident Evil 2. He will do that to your game. It's like,
Yeah, it's impressive.
It's so funny. It almost feels like a Microsoft product. Do you know what I mean? Like, if Steam didn't make this, like, it seems like Microsoft and Nintendo are kind of buddies right now, so they probably wouldn't go against the family that way. But still, this seems like something that they would have been like, yeah, we could do that. Like,
Steam struck at the right moment for sure.
Perfect timing.
Like, they saw what they were doing with the Switch. Now, I haven't spent the extra $80 for the dock.
Sure.
I am not much of like a docked Switch user. I usually play mostly handheld.
Okay.
Unless there's like a Mario Odyssey or Breath of the Wild or something. So I haven't opted for the $80 dock, but so I should also say this is the mid-tier solid state. So this is don't quote me, I think it's the 512 gig solid state. And then you can actually pop in a micro SD card for additional memory. So yeah, 9 out of 10. So far I'm really digging it. I haven't had any issues. And there's still so much untapped possibilities with the emulation and all that stuff.
Yeah.
You can run Windows and do all sorts of crazy, dorky, hackery stuff that I haven't even messed with. So I've just been playing Steam games.
Okay, but Elden Ring, did you say you've tried this out on here?
Yeah, I'm already like 30 hours into it.
And it's
new
running well.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah. I was home sick for like a week, and then we had the holidays and Christmas and stuff. So I've had a lot of time to spend. And I wrapped up God of War, which we can get into at a different time or later in the show. So, yeah, Steam Deck, I'm loving it so far. If you are into PC gaming / handheld gaming, I think this is the perfect device.
Okay.
I think this was like $549.
Okay.
So about $50 more than like a PS5 or a Series X. I think the value's there. It's a little disappointing that it didn't hit like that terabyte solid state drive.
Sure.
Once you get the OS installed, it eats up most of your memory. But luckily, you can pop in a micro SD card. So,
which is really nice. Yeah, I'm so curious to hear if that becomes something for you in the future that you're like, yeah, it's the thing I play over anything else.
Right.
You know.
I would predict that will be the case.
Yeah.
You know, we can get into God of War and stuff in a little bit, but. You know, especially if you install Windows and you have access to Windows Game Pass, which like most Xbox exclusives are on Windows Game Pass.
Sure.
So it's kind of an Xbox.
Yeah.
If you think of it that way.
Yeah, totally. I mean,
really, but it kind of is.
Yeah.
You know, I'm pretty like you can install Halo Infinite on this, on a Steam Deck, play it on your couch, you know.
I'm curious to know how RTS works on there. I'm sure it runs fine. I'm just trying to think of like on a handheld like that to be like.
Yeah, and that's where these little haptic pads come in place.
Okay.
So these serve as mouse pads.
Oh.
So and it actually has like a little haptic touch.
Dang.
So I would assume playing an RTS is no problem. I mean, that's why they put these in there. And then when you're in desktop mode, these serve as keyboard and mouse.
Oh, wow.
So they really thought of everything. It's a busy device.
Yeah.
There's a lot going on, but it never feels uncomfortable or overwhelming.
But it's sleek, you know, and there's something to it that, like, when you see it, it looks like a Switch turned up or like a futuristic-y, edgy Switch, you know?
Yeah, people say it looks like a Game Gear, which cracked me up because I had a Game Gear growing up.
You're
just
like,
a straight black device.
Yeah, you're like, yeah, I mean, kind of. No.
Yeah.
No, so, that is really cool. And also, if you're fighting for screen time, because I know a lot of people, that's becoming more and more of an issue where it's like, you know, partners and somebody wants to watch something on TV and you're like, I want to play Elden Ring, but I can't.
Right.
That's the way to do it.
Yeah. My only knock so far is battery life is not great.
Oh yeah.
Depends what you're playing. I think Elden Ring, if the brightness is at like 3/4, you get like an hour and a half. Not good. But you look at what you're playing.
That's true.
That's true. So, but other games like Super Meat Boy or some indie games, you could probably get 3 to 4 hours.
Okay.
Most of the time I just have it plugged in.
Sure. So you can just have it going continuously.
Most of the time.
Okay. I was going to ask you about
that. If I hit like, you know, you got 20% left, I just plug it in. I don't wait for it to die.
Sure.
Put it that way.
Okay.
So, anyways. That's pretty much all I have to say so far. It is a fun little gadget.
Sure.
And I'm looking forward to doing more with it.
I remember seeing like the advertisements going up for like Jedi Fallen Order and stuff like that. You haven't tried that at all?
Not on the Steam Deck.
Okay. Yeah.
Not on the Steam Deck.
Okay. I don't know why I wanted to ask about that one. I just, for some reason, I felt like
I know it's optimized.
It's optimized. It's optimized. Okay, that's so good. That's
if
good
you
to want know.
To play that, yep.
Yeah.
The great, honestly, the greatest thing I think about Steam is the amount of sales they hold.
It's crazy.
They're like Nintendo and yeah. Sony. It's pretty rare they discount their games, and if they do, it's like they knock 10, 15 bucks off.
Oh, yeah.
You know, over Christmas, you could get, you know, Spider-Man Remastered for like 25 bucks or Elden Ring, I think it was on sale for $41.99 the day after I spent 60 bucks.
Sure.
So that was kind of a...
Is Spider-Man an option for that?
Yeah, Spider-Man Remastered, Miles Morales.
I would love to see how that holds up.
Exactly.
On there, swinging through New York City.
Right. It's shocking the library you have access to between the different platforms.
Yeah.
On one device.
And since Sony's taken the plunge into the PC stuff, that right. means there's less and less of a chance that you're like, yeah. I cannot play this on right. that.
Yeah, Uncharted Collection and God of War 2018 is both on Steam.
Oh, nice.
So
yeah,
you can
exactly.
You can run first-party Sony games. It's kind of a one-and-done console so far.
That's
so,
crazy.
But we'll see.
Cool. Well, yeah. I'm glad you like it so far.
Yeah.
I'm curious to hear future reports and battery yeah. life if that continues to hold.
It is what know. It is.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe through software updates, but it's not surprising.
Yeah.
I mean.
Do they offer some sort of like extension cord? like a 40-foot extension cord. Gabe will deliver it to the house.
Yeah,
like,
right.
This is Gabe the Steam extension cord.
Right,
you're like,
right.
Thank you.
to be fair, the stock USB-C cable is fairly long.
Okay, that's good.
But
that's good.
It could be longer.
It could be
longer.
You're like, so. I want to stretch it across the house. Yeah. I want to walk around with it.
Right.
That's great.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So that's the Steam Deck. So far, I'm really liking it.
Nice.
Yeah.
It's you in the 21st century. Yeah. Maybe the 22nd, depending.
Yeah.
Well, cool. Well, I want to get into God of War.
Okay.
But before we do that, I want to talk about another kind of a tale of woe, as
All right.
it were. I want to talk about A Plague Tale: Requiem.
Nice.
This is the second game in this franchise, as it were, because the first one is Plague Tale: Innocence. I'm not going to lie to you guys. These are two Game Pass games, again, for me. Played through Plague Tale: Innocence, but got to a portion that I hard quit because I was not willing to do a bad thing. I don't know why. I don't know why I felt this way, but I was like, I won't do this. And yet, in Requiem, I did much worse. I did way worse.
You just blew right over those crossroads.
Right over the crossroads. Yeah, just like going through it. Yeah. But it centers on a pair of siblings hundreds of years ago. Hundreds of years
this
ago.
This is the rat game, right?
This is the rat game, yes.
Okay.
Back in France.
Rats Tech.
And you play as Amicia, and you have her little brother, Hugo. So you get kind of those, like, escort mission-y game joke vibes, you know? But
is this, like, Eastern European set kind of deal?
I believe so, yeah. Okay. But it's, man, it's such a gorgeous, wonderful game, and playing through it, it is very much like The Last of Us.
Okay.
So if you like The Last of Us, you will really like this
Interesting.
Game. While there is combat, there's kind of like stealth mainly involved because you're a young woman and her little brother fighting against like knights and stuff. So there's a lot of like sneaking around. If you do get into combat, there's a lot of times where you're like, you want to get out of combat because it can not be great until you're leveled up at the end of the game and then you can kind of blow through most things.
Yeah.
But it's such a wonderful game, and it's constantly doing new things and adding like a new layer or doing something that's like a one-off enemy that has like a falcon that will come and swoop at you, and you just have to like sneak around and get past him, but you never see him again.
Okay.
You know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of just missions where you're just walking through a town and you're talking to people before it gets overrun with this kind of vermintide, as it were, these rats that are coming everywhere because your little brother, Hugo, unfortunately, is a carrier of this plague disease known as the macula.
Okay.
And if he gets overly emotional, he can like summon the rats.
Oh, wow.
And in
so
this
it's a
game,
supernatural thing going
yes.
on.
Yes,
okay.
It's the only supernatural real bent to the game is Hugo.
Okay.
Everything else is pretty grounded.
Okay.
But later on in the game, you do get the ability to control the rats.
Okay.
And you feel like
God-like.
The worst. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
But light is a huge thing in this game. So if you like fire and torches and stuff, that keeps the rats from getting near you.
Okay.
So you got to remember that later on because like there'll be like you'll see a guard with a torch like trying to scare the rats away. You can put out his torch and then the rats will swarm him.
Oh, interesting.
But later on when you're controlling the rats, if that guard has a torch, you can't get to him until you extinguish that flame.
Interesting.
So there's a lot of that. So there's a lot of like light a torch or light a brazier over here so you can get to a place or put something out and get somewhere else or unlock something with your sling because her... A weapon of choice is a sling.
Okay.
So she kind of winds it up and whips it.
Cool.
And that's how you actually, you do destroy or defeat guards, and they do talk about that because the like your companions, who you do get different ones throughout the game as a third party, will comment on it. They'll be like, Amicia, you didn't need to kill that guy. Mm. And she is so angry at the world because the whole world's coming after her little brother.
Interesting.
So you really get this like familial bond, and you're like, I'll protect this kid no matter what. So again, kind of like The Last of Us.
Sure.
And she'll be like, well, they deserved it. You know, that kind of stuff. And I was leaving a trail of bodies because I was like, no, I was like, you stay away from my kid brother. He didn't do anything wrong. It's such a well-done game, really well-acted, voice-acted, great motion capture, and just a gorgeous game.
Yeah.
And it went way longer than I thought.
Really?
And I think that's the same with God of War. I thought, I was like, this will be like pretty short.
Yeah.
No, it went for a long time.
Wow.
I was like 15 chapters worth.
Holy
cow. There's a lot going on. Okay. And you could spend a lot of time just enjoying the sights or appreciating these places that they clearly like will bring you to a new town and they're like, look at how nice it is. Look at all of it. And then like at a chapter later, it's destroyed.
Oh,
like,
because
the rats got there.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's really cool. Okay. And they do a great job of potentially setting it up for way in the future.
Okay.
Because they kind of, there is an ending to this more or less. But yeah, it's a really poignant game.
Okay.
And I found myself being like kind of attached and being like, I got to get back to it. I got to get back to the rats.
Interesting.
But there, if you have a fear phobia of rats or dark places, confined places, probably not this one.
Right. Like,
I would skip it.
Yeah.
Do you have any questions about it?
Yeah, I never played that first game. The first game was kind of like a B game kind of thing, right?
Your first kind of shot at this.
First kind of shot, right? I'm definitely interested. I watched the trailer and I thought it was visually incredible.
Mm-hmm.
I know nothing about the franchise, so it's interesting to hear about. So, but when you mentioned The Last of Us, that has me interested to check it out because I'm a big fan of those games.
Yeah.
So.
And I think this one, you could go right into the sequel here and be all right. They do make some references back to the past.
Okay.
But I still think, like for me, I didn't completely finish that first game, and I still felt like I had a good understanding. It's basically just figure out that bond between these kids and knowing that the whole world is basically after them. And who do they trust? Who do they don't trust?
Sure.
And who they have to take down, who gets in their way.
Interesting. And you're playing on Game Pass as well.
Again, on Game Pass, man.
Another
it's
reason.
This month, I've just been like, man, there's a lot on there. And I think this one came out a little bit longer, a little bit further ago, but still on there. You know, and it
That's
is a
incredible.
Game Pass game.
Yeah.
So, like, it'll be on there, I think, indefinitely.
Okay.
It's not one of those, I think, that'll go away over time.
Okay.
But I don't think they're billing it at a full-priced game either.
Okay.
I don't know. But there is New Game Plus, and you go back with all of the things you've upgraded, because you do upgrade. You can upgrade your sling and your ability to craft and things like that. But also your play style will passively level up or give you different abilities depending on how you play.
Okay.
And at first there was like aggressive, stealth, and then like kind of crafting. And I was like, why am I not getting more for aggressive? But as the game went on, like that little meter went way up and it was like, you got a new ability. So like one of them is like, you can run up to a guard and just shove him into fire or into rats if they're nearby.
Oh yeah.
Which you wouldn't get normally because they're like guys who are two times your size and they'll pick you up and like one shot you if they're like strong enough, but sometimes two shot you and you have to counter and run away.
Okay.
It's a really well done, well thought out game. And I keep thinking, I'm like, man, if they had more time and more budget, I'm just so
what could
excited.
They do?
Yeah, that's why this like third prospect for something that they tease at the end, I was like, this could get real nuts.
That's cool.
But yeah, it's a cool game. It's really cool. It's one of those that like I think would have flown under the radar for many, but because it's on Game Pass and it's getting shown off and it's getting a lot of awards, then it'll be one of those things that people are like, oh yeah, you should check this out.
Right.
You know, versus just kind of skating by.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it was so under my radar.
Yeah.
I'm just so unfamiliar. Other than the fact of watching a trailer and be like, oh wow, that rat tech looks incredible.
Dude, the rat tech is crazy.
Yeah.
And they are like, they're the thing that got me the most in that game. Like as far as like failed states, because they're like, oh, I'm fine in the fire, and then they zoom up on me, like, it's freaky. It really is freaky.
Yeah.
Every time they show up, you're like, how are we going to get through this? And your characters will say it too, and you're like, we always do. I don't know how, but we always do. But some good puzzle solving.
Okay.
You know, you have to really use your brain. And there's a few times where you're like, oh man, I have to deal with these rats again.
Yeah.
You know, but
sure.
Like the way that they implement them, it's typically a little different every time. And then sometimes later on, you just get used to, at least in my play style, how to use them to your advantage.
Got it.
And being like, well, I'm going to take out all the guards and you're not going to be able to stop me. You know, I'm like, go rats. Attack.
Yeah.
Uh, Yeah.
Cool. It's really cool. That sounds interesting. I mean, it's appealing to me that I can drop $15 for a month and get High on Life and Plague Tale.
Yes.
And play two amazing games. Yes. For, you know, 1 month subscription potentially.
Yes.
So both of those games sound really interesting, especially with Game Pass. So
very different games.
Yeah. Yeah.
But great games, but really, but both great. And yeah, I would really tell people, if you're at all interested and have Xbox or Steam, or I don't know if on Switch Game Pass is a thing.
Yeah, not really. Online system, it's more for the retro stuff.
Okay. So now they're doing some sort of partnership. I was like, wait, are people playing Plague Tale on their Switches?
Like, yeah, maybe, unless it's like a cloud-based version or something.
Sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Because this is a gorgeous-looking game, and I would imagine you need to have some decent processing power. Because on the Series X, it ran just perfectly.
Okay.
And there are thousands of rats. Okay. Thousands and thousands and thousands.
Yeah.
And I will say later on, you do get that ability to control them, but it is not overpowered, and you only have a certain amount of time you can use them.
Okay.
So it's not like something where you're just like, well, the game's on easy mode now.
Yeah.
There's still like a lot of like, ugh.
Yeah.
But some really cool visuals, and you go to places you would not think you would go.
Okay.
In medieval France.
Cool. That sounds cool. I definitely want to check this out.
Yeah. So shout out to that team.
Great.
They did a great job in those voice acting. All the acting in that, I was like, oh man, this is really good. I appreciate it more and more now. I'm like, Amicia really brought it. I'm like, man, I get it. I really want to fight for your brother too.
Yeah.
So we did. We took out a lot of French guards.
Nice. Well, I'm looking forward to checking it out.
Yeah.
It was still under my radar, but now I'm interested. So.
Yeah. And speaking about these duos, these parent kind of figures and the children, let's talk a little bit about God of War Ragnarok, a game that I won't play for probably 2 years because there's only 8 PlayStation 5s.
Right.
There, well,
I think it's getting better now, and I think there's a bundle.
Okay, there's a bundle.
Yeah.
I like a bundle.
Right.
Sony Santa Monica. Last time I was on the show here, I was talking to them on the phone.
Yeah.
I'm
going
to be in the next game.
Perfect.
But they still haven't sent me this one.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm really excited.
It's coming.
I can't tell you what I'm going to be in, though.
Yeah.
I signed my life away in the NDAs.
Beautiful.
Signed it away.
Awesome.
But God of War Ragnarok. Okay, so you finished it.
I finished
which
it.
Which is great.
Yep, I finally finished it. I think I talked about it a little bit on the last show, so
yeah.
I won't have to say too much about it. But I liked it. Just to say a couple nice things right off the bat, like it looks incredible.
Okay, yep.
I mean, you know, it looks amazing, but I still don't think it like hit the highs of like Horizon Forbidden West or like Ratchet and Clank on the PS5, but it's up there.
Okay.
A little long for me for you know, if you break down what this game is, it's mainly a linear action adventure game with some minor open world exploration side quests.
Like the first.
Right. It's like it was kind of a good reminder of like, oh, this is kind of like Uncharted.
Yeah.
It's more Uncharted than it is Horizon.
Sure.
Horizon's this full blown open world game where God of War is a little more linear and structured. But I think it was like 40 hours. And that's with, you know, some fairly minimal side quest stuff. So I thought the story was great. I just don't think it was quite as good as that 2018 game.
Sure.
You know,
tight,
it was
focused.
Yeah, much more of that. Mm-hmm. And it's Ragnarok, so it's obviously more of the Norse. You know, you got Thor and you have Odin and some of these other characters. And those. It's interesting to see how they portray those characters. Some great performances.
Cool.
I just, you know, for... When I get in the mindset of kind of like what a linear action adventure game is, 40 hours seems a bit long to me.
It's a lot.
Yeah, it's a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I think the story goes in a way that I was expecting, but the way that you get there, they kind of throw some curveballs at you.
Okay.
So the other thing is you play as Atreus a lot in this game. Which is new. And that's not really a spoiler. It's just it is what it is. So I think the gameplay is split maybe 50-50 between Kratos and Atreus.
What?
And
no.
That,
what?
Yeah.
No.
So brace yourself. So, and I kind of cringed at that idea, but they make Atreus actually really fun to play
as. Okay, good. Thank goodness. I'm like,
so his
I'm
abilities,
there for Kratos.
Right, the way the combat is structured with Atreus and the bow and some of the different dynamics. There's a new weapon that comes into play as well.
Cool.
So, I just, you know, it's. That 2018 game was incredible.
Yeah.
You know, and I love those old games as well.
Mm-hmm.
I would probably put this maybe below most of those games.
Really?
So definitely below 2018. This was like a 7 out of 10 for me.
Okay.
Where that last game was like a solid 9.
Sure.
9.5. Mm. So I liked it. I thought it was beautiful. I think it has some problems. I think there's almost too much puzzle solving.
That's what I want to ask you about, because I try to stay away from reviews of something I haven't seen, typically like a game like this, but I kept seeing things pop up. I was like, this game is frustrating.
Yeah.
And I was like, what's frustrating about it?
Right.
Is it a lot of the puzzly stuff?
Yeah, and it, you know, I don't know if it's just my age or where I'm at. Or maybe Elden Ring just ruined everything for me, because that game is nothing but just gameplay.
Sure,
With very little puzzle solving. But yeah, it has me a little nervous for this Breath of the Wild sequel, just because where I'm at with puzzle solving. So, you know,
I'm
still looking forward to it, obviously.
For that water temple, baby.
Yeah,
let's go.
Oh, man. But there is a lot of puzzle solving in Ragnarok.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
But it depends on your level of patience with that stuff.
Sure.
You know, some of it's not that difficult. Some of it's fairly annoying.
Sure.
It's not that bad.
Sure.
So, yeah, it's a God of War game. I wasn't, like, super impressed with it, but
okay.
I enjoyed it. I thought it was a little long.
Yeah.
I just don't think it hit quite those highs of that 2018 game.
Is it still the one take format that the first game had, that it was just, it's one continuous take the whole time?
Pretty much.
Okay.
It's very much a sequel to that game.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, they don't stray too far.
Sure.
You know.
If it ain't broke.
Yeah, exactly. It's just, it's more of that.
Sure.
You know, I just thought maybe it was a little long.
Sure. 50-50 with Atreus. Are you?
Yeah, I mean, maybe it's like 60-40.
But still, that's a lot.
And there's a lot of Atreus.
Like, okay, that's like, and that's kind of what, like, Last of Us 2 is more, it's just, it's an Ellie game. And, or sorry, Ellie and the antagonist.
Man, it's been so long since I've played it. Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
There's two playable characters.
Yeah.
But that's great that you brought that up, because that was another game that I thought went too long.
Sure.
I don't know what it is with Sony first-party games. Maybe they really want you to get your money's worth.
The quality, like what you were saying, the quality or whatever. The value,
right.
I should say.
Yeah, you're definitely going to get that with God of War.
Get that value.
For sure.
Yeah.
I was just ready to wrap it up around 30 hours.
Sure.
So it went maybe another 10 hours. But if you really love this game, I've heard you could put almost 100 hours into it if you do all the side stuff.
Oh my gosh.
So I think there's a lot there for you to do.
And as somebody who went and made it a point to destroy all the Valkyries in the first
game. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Man, 100 hours?
Yeah.
Do they have new Valkyries?
There are some new Valkyries in
this
game.
They're back. Yeah. They're back, baby.
When you... this isn't really a spoiler. When you end the game, you can still go back into the world.
Okay, good. Yeah,
and wrap
sure.
up some stuff.
So it's not true Ragnarok, because there's a world to come back to. It's not completely destroyed.
Minor spoiler.
That's fine. No, yeah.
So,
that's how those things go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's God of War.
Okay.
It was a fun game. I don't know if I'd play it again.
Okay.
But I'm glad I beat it.
I've got questions.
Okay.
First and foremost, boss fights. Are we doing some different ones other than the troll guy?
Yeah, there are some really epic boss fights, but that was the other thing, too. It didn't, like, hit that epic cinematic level that 2018 did. Like, with remember the big dragon fight?
Yeah, the lightning dragon.
Or the fight in the beginning at the cabin.
Yeah,
They kind of do that again with Thor at the cabin.
Sure.
Minor spoiler, not
That's
really,
fine.
But...
Yeah.
It's really story-heavy, really puzzle-heavy. I wish there was more epic boss fights.
I wanted that, like, you're talking about that first fight with the stranger in the first God of War. And I was like, oh, every god boss fight is going to be like this, where it's like he punches you and you go flying. And
exactly.
I was like, oh, this is going to be incredible.
Yeah.
And they didn't quite do that, which is fine.
Yeah.
But I was kind of hoping for more of that. Because I love, for some odd reason, in games like that, a lot of people go for the spectacle of, like, I'm Kratos, I can fight, like, 30 guys by myself.
Yeah.
I love one-on-one.
Yeah.
Dante versus Virgil. You know what I mean? Like, that kind of stuff.
Yep.
It's just...
Yeah, you will get quite a bit of that within this.
Okay,
just
good.
Just not as much.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, I really like that. I like that sort of thing. So, man, I want to play it, and I will eventually, but it was one of those things that I do have a PlayStation 4. It is available on PlayStation 4.
Sure.
But I'm pretty sure my PlayStation 4, it sounds like it's about to take off anyway. I think if I play that,
explode.
It would hover. It'd be like,
yeah.
And I'd be like, ugh, Kratos, please.
You could give it a shot.
Sure.
You know, if you just want to play it, you don't want to wait.
Sure.
But if you're not in a hurry, I would say just wait.
Yeah, I might just wait.
You know what I mean?
40 hours. That's incredible, though.
It's a long game.
Yeah. And maybe that's part of the mandate for Sony, is that they're like, if you're doing a first-party
maybe.
Game that's like action-adventure, it needs to be this length, because we want people to still get the console for it and be like, it's worth the money.
Yeah.
I don't know. That means the next Spider-Man game is going to be like 80 hours long.
I don't know, man. Could be. Could be. I don't know.
So, yeah. So, you liked it.
Liked it.
Didn't love it.
Exactly.
Won't play it again.
Probably not. And it leaves it in a place where I don't know where they're going to take it next. That's the most interesting thing.
Dang.
Is I don't know where they can take the story from now. So I'm really curious to see where they go.
The original concept for God of War, if I'm not mistaken, Cory, my friend, not you, Cory, other Cory, okay. Cory Barlog.
He
talked about a long time ago wanting Kratos to basically go through all the polytheistic stuff and fight all the pantheons of gods.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So I always thought, okay, maybe if they're not going to do three for this one, because I always think in trilogies, I don't know if people do this, maybe it's movies have made me do this.
Yeah.
But I was thinking, okay, if they're only doing two for this one, mm-hmm. are we going to Egypt next?
Right, exactly.
Are we going ancient Aztec? You know, so there are other things they could go to.
Right. Not to really spoil it, but the only thing I'll say is at the end, Kratos has like a vision.
Sure.
You know, he's looking at something, and I won't say what. You don't really know what, but he has an epiphany, and you know, he's got a plan.
Sure.
He's got to go do some stuff.
Cool.
So obviously, there's going to be another game. I just don't know where it's going
to
go.
Yeah. Well, and they teased that in 2018 as well when you get to like Odin's Vault. Right. There's like the picture of it's like, oh, yeah, this is from the Greco-Roman. Here's Japanese stuff.
Right.
And it's like, okay.
Exactly.
Which I think Kratos still, the way they have him in this, he really translates well into Norse mythology.
Sure.
But it's more and more of a stretch if you're like, if you do bring him, is like he's going to go fight all the Japanese deities. And you're like, they're like, what did we do to you? And he's like, no, I'm taking care of all of you.
Yeah.
Exactly. But still, I would love to see it just because I like Kratos.
Right,
I really
me too.
Do. I always kind of have. But he's evolved a lot over time.
He just gives really long speeches at the Video Game Awards.
Does he really? Is that
Did you see that?
I didn't see that.
It was the longest speech in awards history.
And they didn't stop him.
They started to play music.
And he was like, no, I'm going.
It was ridiculous.
He's got a deep voice.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I know he's emotional, but it was like, come on, man.
Sure.
At that point, it's a little selfish.
And he won it for best performance.
Best performance.
Sure, right? Yeah.
So, anyways.
Okay,
that's a story for another day. But
interesting, though. That's fascinating to me.
Yeah.
Okay, well, yeah, I did want to hear a little bit more about what you thought, now that you completed it, because I didn't know that you actually finished it. So that means that I'm still here in town for a little bit, so I'm going to have to come over many nights now, and I'll be like, all right, we're running through a Cory, and you're going to be like, all right, here's a side path, just go this way.
Right.
It'll be faster.
We'll set a schedule, you can come over 3 hours a night.
Exactly.
Leave,
I'll be like, all right, Tiff, I'm sorry, I'm staying a little bit late tonight.
Right,
It's doable. It's doable. Last thing I need to ask, the combat, does it feel as good, better, worse than the last one?
I would say just as good. You know, the only thing that I'll say with the combat, I didn't really want to get too complicated with it, but I don't like memorizing fighting game movesets in an action game.
I know.
Don't like that. Down, right, up, RB, let X be, you know, it's like, I'm never going to learn those moves.
Yeah.
I'm never going to take the time to do that.
Yeah.
Maybe the minor ones. So they still do that.
Yeah.
It's overcomplicated.
Sure.
You have the axe still.
Leviathan
you have the chains. And there's a new weapon.
Cool.
That's really fun.
Shotgun.
Shotgun. Yeah. Sawed off.
He gets the Doom Slayer shotgun.
Right. Exactly.
Double barrel.
Yeah. So I won't say what it is. You do get a new weapon. It's really cool. It serves a purpose with combat as well as environmental puzzle stuff.
Sure, like the Leviathan Axe before it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember loving that. That Leviathan Axe might be one of my favorite video game weapons of
it's
all
really
time
good.
Because like that was before they got into Mjolnir. And Mjolnir like is used by Thor in this game.
Right.
But I remember they're like, it's basically Mjolnir. You throw an axe, it can come back to you.
Yeah.
But it would freeze people.
Right.
And that was great.
Right.
Like, oh, this thing is sweet.
Yeah.
And every other game I've judged since. And Mjolnir, by the way, in Avengers is pretty good. And I think was the same combat developer from the first God of War.
Okay.
So when you're playing as Thor in that game, it feels a little Leviathan-axe-y. And that's very purposeful.
Okay.
It's like, okay.
That makes sense.
Yeah. I love that axe. Do you still have the bare knuckles and the shield?
You do. Yep. Okay. You do. Lots of loot, lots of gear.
Sure.
Lots of armor sets.
Kratos loves his gear.
Many shields. And the runes, don't forget
the runes.
You got to put the runes in the shield.
Oh my gosh.
It's weird to have such a complicated RPG system in a mainly linear action-adventure game. It's a bit much.
Yeah.
It's a bit much.
Sure.
My only closing comment is, you know, maybe simplify that third game.
Sure.
If that's going to be the next thing.
Sure.
So, and skip the fighting game movesets for an action game.
Yeah,
it's not
a lot.
For me, but that's
so
just me.
But you still made it through on your smaller combos.
Oh yeah.
Okay, great.
Absolutely.
Cool.
Yeah, and I think at one point I dropped it to story mode because the difficulty got to a point. Or
sure,
I was like,
you're just like whatever.
Okay, I just want to get through this.
Exactly.
So it's a tough game.
The older I get, I feel that way too. I'm just like, what? You know, what's the point? Who do I have to prove to anything? I beat Elden Ring. It's fine.
That's right.
I had friends with some of it, but I beat the last guy by myself.
Yep. Just want to see the story.
Just want to see the story.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's totally true. Okay, well, it's good to know. One other thing I will say about this is I'm totally fine paying full price for a game like this that has that amount of value, again, mm-hmm. as we're talking about, and all those things that normally, if this game were $30 or $40,
right.
it would be rife with microtransactions.
Totally.
And I'm glad, because like I would hate to be like, oh, if you want, for $2, you can buy this rune, or have a chance to right. get this rune that will really help you.
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
no. Like, no, Kratos is not a gambler. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, he's yeah. a winner.
Right.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, you're totally right. Yep. $70.
$70. See, that game, I get where it's like, all right, this is first party title, 40 yeah. hours.
Right.
That to me, I'm like, sure.
Yeah.
But now all the games are switching to 70.
Right.
Which, again, I know people have talked about this for a long time. Video games are the one type of thing that have stayed at like 60 for so long.
True.
That like it does hurt to go up to 70, but at the same time, it's like, I'm yeah. surprised you didn't do it sooner.
Yeah,
you
know? Yeah. True. That's true.
So, but yeah. don't get any ideas, video games. yeah. I don't want to be sitting here and be like, it's $90. Yeah. You know, it's like, ah,
yeah.
You know. Special editions, sure. If you want to go $200, that's fine.
Right.
I want to talk about a game with loot, though.
Okay.
Something that I got into recently, and I can't believe it, Corey. I kind of streamlined it a little bit with a friend. There's a lot yeah. of end game, but loot in Gotham Knights.
You went for it.
I did go yeah. for it. I wanted to play this game for a long yeah. time.
Right, I'm you were excited fan. About it.
Yeah, I was excited. I think yeah. I talked about it on this show. But the Arkham games have been favorites of mine, especially mm-hmm. City. A lot of people, it's like either like Asylum or City. I was right. a City boy.
Yeah.
And Knight
City's great.
Knight is good. You've betrayed me, though. Yeah. They took my favorite character, Deathstroke, and they relegated him to a tank boss fight.
Yeah.
And Batman defeated him instantly upon getting out of the tank. I don't want to talk about it. Anyway. Yeah. But so Gotham Knights, made by the same people who made Arkham Origins, which was a game that I really did enjoy back in the day, set at Christmas time. And
right.
you're being attacked by 7 or 8 different assassins.
Right.
This is WB Montreal.
Okay.
And the big kind of conceit or cool hook to this game is that you can play as one of 4 of the Bat family, but not Batman himself.
Right.
This is also not a game that takes place canonically in the Arkham universe. This is like an offshoot. So
right.
don't worry about that if you're like...
Because they just showed in the Suicide Squad trailer that Batman is back in that game.
Yes, Batman's in that game.
So that's, I'm really interested about that.
That's the Rocksteady stuff. That's,
this is separate.
Yeah, Suicide Squad kills the Justice League or
yeah,
whatever it is.
Yeah.
It's a crazy long name.
Yeah.
But Gotham Knights, and it's one, like I said, I've wanted to play for a long time, and it does feature 2-player co-op
okay.
In the open world and through the story. There are 4-player co-op big like assault missions where you can have everybody there.
Okay.
And to my understanding, I don't think it limited us to being like, if I'm playing as Nightwing and you play as Red Hood, I couldn't switch to Red Hood. I think we both could play
Interesting.
As Red Hood.
Okay.
The thing is, like, whoever procced the cutscenes, which normally it was my game world,
mm-hmm.
I was playing as Robin.
Right.
So it was a lot of Robin. But sometimes my buddy Joe, shout out to Joe,
yeah.
Who's playing Red Hood, he would get in there. So some of the cutscenes would be him.
Okay.
So we got a little bit of a mix,
got
which
it.
Was nice. And I really appreciate
That's
that.
That's cool. That's cool.
All the characters play pretty differently
okay.
In their special abilities. But for the most part, they retain that kind of the dodge, counter, attack
mm-hmm.
style.
Okay.
It is nowhere near as smooth as Bats, though. Like, you
okay.
could, I don't know if this was intentional, but Batman feels like on a different level
oh,
than
really?
These guys.
Okay.
For the most part.
Yeah.
Their special abilities are very powerful. But when you're playing as Batman,
yeah.
like, you do feel like a one-man army.
Right.
Whereas this, because it's an RPG, too,
mm-hmm.
there's levels involved and gear and all that stuff where you can get beat up pretty easily if
okay.
you're not smart about it.
Got it.
So it feels like they took Batman almost and split him into like 4 different characters.
Interesting.
A little bit.
Okay.
Because, for instance, everybody's got their own version of traversal in this game. Everybody's got a grapple hook.
Got it.
But, for instance, Batgirl, she gets the cape later on. But Robin, he has like a boom tube and he can kind of teleport.
Okay.
So they don't all fly around.
Sure.
Which is
sure.
sad because one of the best parts of the Arkham games, especially City,
yeah.
is your ability to fly around like that. And
sure.
it's like yeah. I wish, like, it'd be weird to have Red Hood have a big cape.
Right.
But it
yeah.
would still be like, okay, that'd be nice.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is cool. And again, playing with a friend, it was great to like go into a room. They had the Predator style rooms again, where it's like, okay, you can sneak into a room
yeah.
and you have to take all these guards down.
Yep.
You could go loud, as we like to say. You can go
yeah.
in there and start fighting everybody. But you have bonuses to be like, oh, it's silent takedowns. Do 5 silent takedowns.
Okay.
But coordinating attacks was really fun.
Right.
So it was a lot of like, all right, hey, can you take this guy? I'm going to take this guy. And like, now.
Playing with a human friend.
It felt very yeah. much more like Ghost Recon at times.
Oh, that's cool.
Which was nice. And I was like,
that's
yeah.
cool.
So that was fun because I was
yeah.
not used to that because I'm so used to playing alone
yeah.
as Batman, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, so those four playable characters, I tried all of them out. I think Robin was my favorite, and that's Tim Drake.
Okay.
That Robin, Jason Todd as Red Hood. You've right. got Dick Grayson as Nightwing, and then Barbara Gordon as Batgirl.
Okay.
And again, while, like I said, they're supers, their costumes, all that stuff is different, they all are fundamentally the same.
Okay.
There are just ones that excel at different things. So for instance, Robin, who I was playing as, was more of a stealth specialist.
Okay.
So there are like regular guards, but then there'll be like these bigger, tougher guards. Mm-hmm. And only Robin, you can unlock this with him, he can stealth take down the big guards.
Okay.
But for another thing, my buddy who was playing Red Hood, he could actually grapple the big guards when they got to a certain health point.
Okay.
So that was something, and then you can do little tag team attacks,
yeah,
which are fun.
That's cool.
I wanted way more of that. I was not like, bad. Yes, because there was, after a while, we got to this point where we wouldn't even say it, but at the last person we would fight in these combat encounters, he would always hold them for me, and I would just run up and we'd do the tag team attack.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, nice. Yeah, I was like, good job, buddy. So yeah, it was fun, but we kind of went, we ran through it. And this is where I've heard maybe some of the, I don't know if it's frustration or the grind comes in, because what you do later on is eventually you get gear that is legendary.
Okay.
But to level up that gear, you have to just keep using it.
Got
so you it. Just have to go around and stop these premeditated, smaller little crimes that are happening. Not mm-hmm. big, big crimes, but sure. smaller ones. And that's how you get strong enough to do the end game, like the big heroic assaults, or go back and fight the bosses at their highest difficulty.
Okay.
Because they have three that I know of that are special Batman villains that most people would recognize.
Okay.
And they have like kind of these cool like ramp ups in like to the actual final encounter with them.
Okay.
And they are specialized missions where like you have to gather enough intelligence and then you will load into a special mission just for them.
Interesting.
And then you have to kind of go, and there's like a few of them until you bring them back to justice.
Okay.
So they showed off the Mr. Freeze one a while ago, but the one that they showed was actually like halfway through his arc.
Okay.
Or whatever, or yeah. that kind of quest chain.
Okay.
And they have level difficulties. They're like, we recommend you be from here to here.
Yeah.
You can try to not, but sure. it's a lot harder.
Right.
And I don't know if they changed this, but originally I think the game was, if I was level 19, the world would always be level 20. It was always one level ahead.
Okay.
And I was like, yeah. And I don't think that's the case anymore because, I don't know, for people who play RPGs, one of the best things is getting to a point where you are way stronger
yeah.
and you can come back and crush someplace. You're like, yeah, I'm right. level 20, this is level 5.
Right.
It's done. But yeah, it was good. And I got it, as I was telling you before, it was on sale. The deluxe version was like half off or like $25 off, so it's like yeah. $45.
Yeah.
And I was like, totally fine.
Perfect.
I'm like, okay, perfect.
Perfect.
And because it's still running at 30 frames per second on console, I was like, okay, I'm more forgiving of this.
Yeah.
Because if I would have paid full price, I'd be like,
yeah.
And that's why I didn't get it originally.
Right. Well, like, I'm glad you waited.
Yeah.
Because I know you really wanted to play.
I did. So, I was like, oh, yeah. I want to play. I'm like, ooh, I'm hearing weird things. So
yeah.
I'm like, I don't know.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's an interesting game, and
okay.
they clearly love their characters. There's a lot of like optional little side conversations you can have,
okay.
little cutscenes between them.
Yep.
But yeah, I don't know. Is there any interest for you?
Yeah, possibly.
Okay.
Yeah, when I heard it was, you know, had some performance issues and it was locked to 30 frames,
yeah.
and people didn't seem super stoked. But like you, if I found it on a sale, I mean, I love those Arkham games.
Dude.
You know, and I love those characters, so totally.
I play through it totally. With you in a heartbeat.
Yeah.
And one thing that's really cool I noticed, like, let's say, I think if it was your world and I went into it and you were a higher level than me,
mm-hmm.
my stats would jump up to meet yours.
Oh, that's cool.
And I don't know if it'd be the opposite where if it's like you just started and I played with my high level character,
sure.
it would drop down, or okay. if I'm just one-shotting everything.
Yeah,
which
yeah.
would be kind of funny, too. I'd be like, okay,
yeah.
here we go. But yeah, it's one of those things that I think, again, if we played together,
yeah.
you'd probably enjoy. I don't know, where are you on the Xbox? You still?
I'm going to get the X because the S just isn't cutting it.
Dude, Series
yeah,
X
Yeah, especially
great.
With stuff coming out, you know, with Starfield coming up and, you know, Microsoft's finally going to be putting out some AAA exclusives
yep.
and stuff. So yeah, I am going to upgrade. It's just a matter of when.
And I don't know if PlayStation 5 has this, but the quick resume, we were talking about this before
yeah.
the show. The quick resume, it's kind of mixed results, but it's so nice, especially being home
right.
as I am right now, because there's a lot of like, I'm just sitting down to play a game and mom
right.
calls in and I'm like,
yeah.
I have to shut this down. And then I come
yeah.
back to it and it just right from there.
Yeah.
It works better with your single player stuff like Plague Tale.
Okay.
It goes right back in. I've noticed issues in more like co-op games or bigger open world games where there's like technical issues
okay.
where you come back in, so it's better to shut Arkham Knights or
yeah.
Gotham Knights all the way down
right.
and then reopen it all the way back up.
Okay.
So yeah, jump in.
Avoid the quick resume.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But it works.
Sure.
But again, High on Life was another perfect one. It worked just fine.
Got it.
Not a problem.
Got it.
But yeah, drop in, drop out co-op. all that stuff. There's really low barrier for entry on this, which is nice, because sometimes co-op games are a hard sell for some of my friends, and it's even worse if you're like, well, you got to go put this code in, and you got to go here and set up an account.
Right.
And
it's like, they make it too complicated.
It's like, it's too much.
Yeah.
It's too much.
Right.
But yeah, if you ever want to pick that up, it is. I think it's worth that price point for like $45 or $40 to me seemed really good. There is a lot in this game.
Okay.
A lot of customization. A lot of transmog, so like if you get a suit that's good and you don't like the look of it, you can just switch it out to something else that you can't. Like, cool. It'll be like, this is the look, you can't change the color scheme on it.
Yeah.
But a lot of the ones you just get right from the get-go or as you level up, you can change out the cowl or the arms or the legs and stuff.
Okay.
So it's a lot of like looking good's feeling good, as my friend likes to say.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, you can really have some fun with that.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That sounds like fun.
It is. It's
good. That sounds
good.
Like fun.
It is good.
I'm glad you got it.
Yeah, I heard mixed reviews on it, and I understand it, but at the same time, it's one of those things where it's like, I think it's getting better with age.
Yeah.
And there's clearly room for, like, DLC.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Maybe they'll chip away at it over time.
And I was really hopeful that, like, Batman would just be unlockable at the end. They'd be like, oh, by the way, you beat the game. Here's Batman.
Yeah,
he's got everything. And you'd be like, oh, Bats is here. Because I was missing him because I remember playing those games, and he's just so good.
Yeah.
He's so good.
Yeah.
He's
got everything. Always have those games to go back to.
Oh, my. Well, it's tempting. I just also want, like, a Deathstroke and stuff because, like, some of the Red Hood outfits my buddy was using, he looked like Deathstroke. I was like, oh, please.
Yeah.
Give me Deathstroke.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. But yeah, Suicide Squad.
Yeah.
It'll be similar to that.
Kevin Conroy's last game, I think.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, they showed him in that trailer. It was a little tribute for him.
Yeah.
So, okay.
It's one of those things that I'm really curious to see that because I'm sure a lot of comparisons will be drawn between this and that.
Right.
Four-player open world co-op.
Right. Set in the same universe, but kind of separate from each other.
Yes.
Right.
But yeah, so are you going to be day one on that, do you think?
I have no idea.
It looks
weird.
Time
will tell,
man.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah,
right?
I have no idea. It's not at the top of my list that I'm like eagerly anticipating, but I'm curious about it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I'm just, I just want to play King Shark.
Yeah.
It seems
like
a really weird character to play in a game like this. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think it'll be fun. I mean, Rocksteady is a reliable studio.
They're so good.
I mean, they have a great track record, even with Knight, like you said.
Even with the failure of what they did to Deathstroke,
and the overuse of the tank and the Batmobile.
Oh, I both like love, but also kind of abhor the Batmobile.
Yeah,
and they have bat cycles in this game.
Yeah.
That they don't have, they have like little time trials and stuff you can do with it. They don't use it like, it's not like integral, like in Arkham Knight, where it's like, a 60-40 split.
Yep.
40% of that game's in the Batmobile.
It's crazy, dude.
You're like...
To be fair, the combat's fun.
It is fun.
In the Batmobile, and it's really
fun.
Impressive tech, but it's just too much.
It's too much.
It was just too much.
Yeah.
Arkham Asylum was kind of like a Metroid game.
Yes.
It was kind of like them dipping their toe in the water, just trying to figure this universe out, and then City was just like their epic, sort of, I hate to use the word masterpiece, but it's really the only word that comes to mind.
The grapnel boost, come on.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's really fun.
Oh,
that Mr. Freeze fight and everything, it's really good, so.
Which, they have Freeze in this game, and he's nowhere near as intelligent. They don't do that kind of
stuff. Oh, I'm sure not.
The mechanics of this one seem... like streamlined.
Okay.
But there's also so many, like there's four different characters, so maybe that was the point.
Right.
Of. I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Well, I'm curious about it, and I'm glad you got it on sale, because that's why you wait.
Exactly.
Sometimes, you know, and if you're unsure on something, just wait, get it on sale, and I'm so glad you had fun with it, because you were skeptical.
I was skeptical.
You were excited about it.
I was like, oh no, please, and then I was playing, I'm like, this is fun.
Yeah.
I'm having a good time.
We've talked about
late.
It on the show before, and then it landed, and it was like, ooh, maybe not.
Dude,
so,
stayed up to like 1 or 2 in the morning playing with my buddy.
That's awesome, man.
I'm just like, here we go. We're going to keep going.
That's great.
Well, Corey, I wish we could sit here all day and talk about all this stuff.
Same.
But they're going to have to kick us out eventually.
That's right. Well, you
like,
broke in the first place.
I did break in the first place. So,
and you still have that knife.
I saw that
so
knife. Exactly.
Worried.
Knifey. No, exactly. He helped me get in.
Right.
But yes, the next time we do the show, who knows? I might be remoting in, or who knows what's going to happen.
We'll play it by ear.
Yeah.
But it's really nice to have you here.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. And
I
appreciate QCTV. Everybody making this go on behind the scenes, thank you so much.
Indeed. Thank you.
And also just keep it locked here at QCTV, because you never know where I'm going to pop up next.
That's right.
Because I might show up somewhere else. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, you will.
What a tease.
That's right.
Yeah. And if you like me, just look up Jimmy Good on YouTube. You'll probably find me. That's the hope anyway. Thanks, YouTube algorithm.
Yeah.
But until next time, dear viewer, take care.